A strong earthquake in the Northeast Pacific, widely predicted over the next few years, will most likely create waves large enough to wipe out entire cities in the northwestern U.S. Evacuation towers may be the only hope if they are ever built. But there's no money. How, then, to save ourselves from the dual threat? And why are we certain that sooner or later, this catastrophe will reach us? In the year 1700, a massive tsunami hit the east coast of Japan, leaving a lasting impact on the collective Japanese consciousness. What made this event so remarkable was that it occurred without any accompanying earthquake, catching the population completely off guard. The waves crashed into the shores without warning, causing extensive damage and numerous casualties. The tsunami swept through several coastal towns, demolishing buildings and dragging boats and people out to sea. It annihilated every resource in its path within a matter of minutes. This devastating natural disaster arrived in the dead of night between January 27th and 28th, 1700, with waves reaching a height of at least 4 meters. The destruction was catastrophic, destroying at least 10% of the buildings in its wake. This geographical expanse of the tsunami affected over 1,000 kilometers of coastline, leaving significant and long-lasting consequences. The question remains, where did this tsunami come from, and what was its origin? For over 3 centuries, one question has remained unanswered, earning the 1700 tsunami the nickname Orphan. This devastating event was unique in that it occurred without any warning earthquakes, unlike the tsunamis that followed on Japan's Pacific coast. This enigma has puzzled scholars for years, leaving the Orphan tsunami to take on the guise of myth in Japan. Despite numerous attempts to solve this mystery, science has been unable to provide a satisfactory answer. However, in 1960, a powerful earthquake in Chile with a magnitude of 9.5 triggered a transoceanic tsunami that hit the Japanese coast with tremendous force. This event sparked a tentative idea that the solution to the 1700 question might lie on the other side of the Pacific. Debate ensued, with conjectures and theories being thrown around. But concrete evidence was needed. It was not until a U.S. geologist and Professor Brian Atwater discovered something groundbreaking in the 1960s. He found that the Cascadia area, previously thought to be incapable of generating earthquakes greater than a magnitude of 7.0, held the key to unlocking the secrets of the 1700 tsunami. The search for answers to this age-old question has been a long and arduous journey. But thanks to Atwater's discovery, we can now begin to unravel the mysteries of the 1700 tsunami. Nestled between the rugged Cascade Range to the east and the vast expanse of the Pacific Ocean to the west, lies a breathtaking mountain range, the Cascade Range. With its snow-capped peaks, verdant valleys, and pristine lakes, this natural wonder is a sight to behold. As you explore the region, you'll be captivated by its wild beauty and diverse wildlife. Whether you're hiking through the lush forests, skiing down the powdery slopes, or simply taking in the stunning vistas, the Cascade Range is an experience that will leave you in awe. So come and discover the majesty of this magnificent mountain range. You won't be disappointed. The term Cascadia doesn't just refer to the region stretching from British Columbia down to Northern California, but also to a subduction zone located in the Pacific itself. This zone lies off the coast of the United States and Canada between Vancouver Island and California. There's a compelling piece of evidence that suggests a significant event took place on January 26, 1700 at around 9 p.m. The Cascadia subduction zone caused a very powerful earthquake, likely measuring between 8.7 to 9.2 on the magnitude scale. The rupture plane was likely 800 to 900 kilometers long and at least 100 kilometers wide, with the epicenter located in the sea. The earthquake caused a coastal subsidence, resulting in the soil sinking by at least a meter. Additionally, a tsunami hit the Canadian and U.S. coastlines with waves potentially reaching heights of 9 to 10 meters. This natural disaster may have destroyed several Native American villages, which were still unexplored by European settlers at the time. This pattern of events is well documented in both North American and Japanese historiography. While some experts may scoff at this theory, citing the fault origin length is too high and the magnitude is never before seen in Cascadia, the events remain quite convincing. After conducting extensive research, many experts now anticipate a potentially devastating earthquake striking Vancouver, Seattle, and the surrounding regions. The consequences of such an event could be catastrophic, leaving a lasting impact on the affected areas. Proper precautions and measures must be taken to prepare for such an occurrence and minimize its potential damage. The safety and well-being of the communities at risk should be of utmost importance, and efforts should be made to ensure their protection in the face of this potential threat. It's no secret that Cascadia is a ticking time bomb. Experts predict that sooner or later, a major earthquake will trigger a devastating tsunami that could span oceans. Even the most skeptical among us will have to acknowledge that the orphan tsunami of the 1700s has finally found its father. Sadly, the people of Cascadia will be faced with yet another looming threat in the coming decades. The question on everyone's mind is whether we truly understand the gravity of the situation and if we're adequately preparing for what's to come. Hang on a sec before we continue. Make sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell. You'll help us to make products of even higher quality. Tsunamis are among the world's most destructive and catastrophic events, with towering waves generated by earthquakes or underwater eruptions. It's important to note that they're not to be confused with tidal waves, which are a result of wind and water interactions that we've learned to predict. Certain areas of the world are more prone to tsunamis than others, such as Japan, which is still reeling from the devastating March 2011 tsunami that claimed the lives of 15,000 people and damaged the Fukushima power plants. Southeast Asia is also no stranger to these natural disasters, with the December 26, 2004 tsunami claiming the lives of a staggering 230,000 people. We must take the threat of Cascadia's impending earthquake and tsunami seriously. We must prioritize preparedness and work together to ensure that we're equipped to deal with the aftermath of such a catastrophic event. The potential threat of a tsunami hitting the Pacific coast of the United States has captured the imagination of many. The double destructive event has already become part of the common imagination, and locals have even given it a name, the really big one, in almost proud opposition to the California's big one. It is the earthquake that sooner or later will inevitably shake the west coast of the United States with a magnitude of at least 9 on the Richter scale. As a result, wave trains may be unleashed that will wipe out entire coastal cities. The epicenter of this earthquake is likely to be the Cascadia Fault, which spans an enormous 960 kilometers along the northwest coast of the Pacific Ocean from Vancouver to California. Subduction zones are responsible for the creation of fault lines and volcanic chains. Cascadia is no exception, as it is situated where tectonic plates meet near the Pacific coast and the Cascadia Mountains form to the east. This volcanic chain boasts notable peaks such as Mount St. Helens, Mount Hood, and Mount Rainier. The Juan de Fuca plate is currently pushing beneath the North American plate, generating a tremendous amount of energy that is building up and will eventually have to be released. Researchers have estimated that the total plate motion is around 30 millimeters per year, and in northern Vancouver Island, it is about 45 millimeters. The potential consequences of this earthquake aren't dire, as the massive wave trains it could generate would be capable of devastating entire coastal communities. The West Coast must prepare itself for this inevitable seismic event and take steps to mitigate the damage it could cause. Scientists have estimated that there is a 1 in 9 chance of the occurrence happening within the next 50 years. As we brace for the immense power of the earthquake, we anticipate the earth shaking for a staggering 3 to 6 minutes. But the devastation won't stop there. The energy will spread to the wave that will begin forming on the ocean surface directly above the fault. The speed of the tsunami is determined by the ocean's depth. The deeper the ocean, the faster the tsunami travels, and conversely, the shallower the ocean, the slower it travels. In our situation, the first wave of the tsunami, followed by several others, will hit the coast in less than 20 minutes. Coastal cities in the states of Washington, Oregon, and Northern California will be submerged under 10 feet of water in just 15 minutes. The fault lies just 100 kilometers away from the coast, and the expected subduction will cause the entire area to sink abruptly to 2 meters below ground. Escaping the disaster would be an arduous task. The scientists predicted roads will be destroyed and submerged or covered with debris, while the deadly wave could pave its way from the Strait of Juan de Fuca to Puget Sound. In the event of a mega earthquake, even cities as far inland as Seattle and Portland could face the devastating impact of a tsunami. The question then becomes, what makes the difference between life and death? Surviving during natural disasters such as earthquakes and tsunamis is heavily dependent on various factors. One of the most crucial determinants is how quickly individuals can distance themselves from hazardous areas. While early warning systems can be helpful, they may not provide sufficient time to evacuate during local events in subduction zones. In some regions, tsunamis can hit up to 10 to 15 minutes after an earthquake, leaving no time to wait for alerts. Recent seismic activities have offered valuable insights into the factors that decide who survives during natural disasters and who doesn't. Interestingly, it's often the human factor that plays a significant role. The devastating earthquake that hit Port-au-Prince, Haiti in 2010 was 500 times weaker than the one that struck Chile the following month. However, the Haitian earthquake caused 5 times more damage and claimed more than 500 lives, while the Chilean earthquake occurred in a less populated area. While luck played a part in this, it's not the only factor. Disaster experts have learned that the ability to move quickly and efficiently away from hazardous zones is critical for survival. In the face of such calamities, it's vital to act fast and follow safety protocols to minimize the risks. Chile, boasting the highest number of seismologists per capita compared to any other country, has implemented strict building codes that prioritize earthquake readiness. Additionally, the Chilean population is well trained in responding to seismic activity. These measures ensure that the country is well prepared for any potential earthquake. The Haitian capital, by contrast, was totally devoid of building codes and was overcrowded with poor residents who had no idea what to do in case of disaster. The two earthquakes follow a well-established pattern. Earthquake disasters kill far more people in poor, disorganized countries than in developed ones. This is unfortunately true, but even in rich countries like the U.S., urban planning is a necessarily slow business. Skylines turn over slowly, and rebuilding the entire urban core of the city overnight is simply not in anyone's budget. The real problem, of course, is to bring all the buildings in Cascadia up to earthquake-proof standards, but that only covers one aspect of the coming catastrophe. If we are saved from the earthquake, then we will immediately have to think about the coming tsunami, and possibly how to rise in altitude within about 20 minutes, which is easier said than done. In coastal towns, there are already signs and directions of routes to take to get to safety, but that's not enough. In fact, almost all of the Cascadia towns have only one road running through the built-up area that could provide an escape route, and this road, one can swear, would immediately be invaded and blocked by thousands of cars. From an emergency management point of view, access is everything. It's easier to deal with 10,000 hungry, thirsty, and injured people than displacing them along a free-flowing road with 500 people in a town whose only way to safety in the hills has been blocked or destroyed. Authorities say you need to be able to respond quickly, and that means already having a plan in place before the earthquake occurs. You should know in advance where to seek shelter and how to get there, and perhaps most importantly, you should practice. However, almost nothing has yet been done to remedy the problem of quick evacuation. Ocean Shores is a town of 7,000 in the United States of America, located in Washington State. It stands on a strip of land separating the Pacific Ocean from an inland lagoon, and it will likely be one of the first settlements to be wiped out by the fury of the earthquake and tsunami. Every month, the 350 children of the local elementary school engage in an earthquake drill. A tremor is simulated, an alarm goes off, and the children run for shelter under their desks. They stay under there for 2 minutes, and then altogether they climb the stairs to the second floor to avoid the incoming tsunami. Yes, you got it right. That drill is most likely completely unnecessary. Indeed, almost all public schools in the Pacific Northwest are at risk of falling on their occupants during an earthquake of this magnitude. It certainly won't be school desks that will save children, nor will running to the second floor to save themselves from the tide if the building collapses. Given the situation today, most structures in the Willamette Valley in southern Oregon will suffer immense damage and collapse. Even older buildings in Seattle and western Washington were certainly not built to withstand the really big one. Buildings made of unreinforced masonry, such as many of Spokane's older brick buildings or rigid concrete, are particularly susceptible to collapse. Low-lying coastal neighborhoods in Washington, Oregon, and Northern California would all be under at least 10 feet of water, with Ocean Shores Elementary School itself facing flooding that could be as much as 7 feet deep. Although scientists have been warning for years of the danger and inevitability of such an event, there are no reefs, natural or man-made, or elevated structures along the coast on which to climb to safety. This would lead to a huge human loss toll, not to mention all the other living creatures. In Washington state, at least half the population could not find a nearby elevated place to escape to within 15 minutes. The Washington State Division of Emergency Management estimates that nearly 90,000 people live or work in the outer coastal flood zone, and there are another 86,000 along inland waterways that the waves will take longer to reach. The Resilience Institute at Western Washington University has calculated that as many as 28% of residents would not be able to reach higher ground in time to escape the tsunami, and 18%, up to 60,000 people, would be swept away or swept out to sea. Representatives of many coastal cities are lobbying state governments, calling for a network of elevated buildings and platforms along the coast that could provide an escape route for thousands of people. Washington state officials have estimated that 58 vertical evacuation structures would be needed along the coast, but throughout the northwest coast, only two have been built, one at Newport State University in Newport, Oregon, and one at Washington Elementary School. A vertical evacuation structure is a building or mound of earth specially designed to withstand the forces of earthquakes and tsunamis, and its height allows people to evacuate above flood level. These buildings are particularly important where there is no high ground or where local seismic sources do not allow people sufficient time to evacuate between the time an earthquake occurs and the time the first tsunami wave reaches the shore. Vertical evacuation structures are a fairly new concept that have proven effective. Some survivors of the 2004 Indian Ocean tsunami were saved because they evacuated in a multi-story concrete building. In all of Cascadia, at least 300 would be needed, along with the construction of redundant escape routes. There is a shortage of money, and politicians don't feel like backing expensive prevention campaigns for an event that will almost certainly happen when they are already retired and away from the political arena. This is the way of the world, guys. It will end up with Cascadia doing things halfway on the cheap, hoping as usual for divine benevolence, with the gates of hell open for everyone.